The next part of this presentation is going to focus on some GI-related issues that are commonly seen in children with special health care needs. So when we think of normal digestion, it's important to remember that each particular region of the gut has a unique function that's integrated into the big picture, which is digestion. The integrated transit of nutrients requires a highly sophisticated control system, and it relies on muscular physiology, the nervous system, and the endocrine system. Disordered motility, or dysmotility, can present as an abnormality in motility of the upper GI tract, the small intestine, or even the colon. And children who present with dysmotility issues often have challenges with feeding tolerance, vomiting, reflux, diarrhea, and or constipation. GER, or gastroesophageal reflux, is very common in infants, and it's severe enough to require treatment in approximately 1 out of every 300 to 1,000 children. About 60% of infants with reflux will grow out of it by about 18 months of age when the child gains muscular strength and acquires a more upright lifestyle and they start to walk. Untreated reflux can cause pain associated with eating and can lead to poor intake, poor growth, and feeding difficulties that are a real challenge for us to fix. Therefore, minimizing reflux early on is an important step that we're going to focus on today. Malabsorption and maldigestion of nutrients can present as poor growth, abdominal discomfort, nutrient deficiencies, and can relate to feeding challenges. With all the great formula options that we have now, optimizing the absorption of nutrients by altering the protein, the carbohydrate, and even the fat composition is certainly feasible. Bowel management is another very, very common GI-related issue that we all deal with quite often when working with children with special health care needs. Constipation exists when the stools are hard, dry, and eliminated with difficulty. There are numerous causes for constipation, ranging from anatomic, such as an anorectal malformation, to neurologic or a muscular disorder, such as myelomeningocele or Hirschsprung's disease. And constipation can result from undernutrition, such as inadequate fiber or fluid intake, or it can be functional, where the child is withholding as well. As I discussed in the previous slide, gut motility is a complex process which integrates neurological, chemical, and muscular processes. And in healthy children, gastric emptying is stimulated by sensors triggered by the presence of food within the stomach. And the pylorus relaxes and releases the contents of the stomach into the small intestine. However, in the child with dysmotility or delayed gastric emptying, we can see a significant delay in this process. This results in feeding tolerance difficulties and can present in a number of ways. So for example, we might see worsening reflux, which can result in significant discomfort and lead to other problems. We might see retching in the child who is status post fundoplication, or we might see an inability to tolerate adequate feeding volumes or even trying to get the child up to feeding rate goals. In all these cases, optimizing gastric emptying would help achieve more successful feeding. So this slide clearly shows a difference in the physical characteristics of casein versus whey when placed in an acidic environment. Casein is acid sensitive and will coagulate in the acidic stomach environment, whereas whey will remain a liquid in the stomach environment. So what is whey protein? Human milk, as compared to cow's milk, is predominantly whey-based and has an approximate whey-to-casein ratio of 80 to 20 shortly after birth, and then this transitions to about 60 to 40 by late lactation. Whey protein, as previously whey-based, and has an approximate to cow's milk, is predominant whey protein as previously 40 by late lactation. For human milk, very easy to digest. Cow's milk, on the other hand, is casein predominant, and the casein portion of cow's milk forms visibly thick curds in an acid environment, which is great for making cheese, but not for optimizing gastric emptying. Whey protein can provide advantages to both healthy children as well as to those with illness. Whey protein can promote growth and development via its complete high-quality protein composition. Whey protein facilitates the tolerance via its ease of digestibility, particularly when it's provided in a hydrolyzed form. And whey protein can be useful in metabolic stress with its rich source of branched-chain amino acids. And whey protein also appears to contribute to the body's antioxidant status via its role as a precursor to glutathione. And we're now going to focus on specialized applications of whey protein. This study by Fried and Koshu, published in the Journal of Pediatrics in 1992, studied spastic quadriplegic children with documented delayed gastric emptying and frequent vomiting on a casein-based formula. The children were randomized in a double-blind study to receive whey-based formulas and a casein-based formulas. Gastric emptying scans were done at both 60 minutes and also 120 minutes. And the formulas that were tested were, the first formula on the slide shows the 80% casein-based formula. Second one, which is the orange diagonal stripes, is the whey predominant formula, which was 60% whey. The third formula was a whey hydrolysate formula with 100% whey. And the fourth formula was also a whey hydrolysate with 100% whey, but it also included 70% MCT as its fat source. And as you can see from this slide, the gastric residuals were significantly higher with the casein predominant formula as compared with all the whey-based formulas at both time intervals, 60 and 120 minutes. And just as a point of reference, normal healthy individuals retain approximately 47% of formula after 1 hour and 22% at 2 hours. So after the scanning part of the study, children were then randomized to each take one of the formulas for a month, and caregivers kept diaries on the frequency of vomiting. And in all the patients fed the whey-based formulas, there was a significant reduction in the episodes of vomiting as well. So these authors concluded that whey-based formulas reduced the frequency of vomiting by improving the rate of gastric emptying. And this was independent of all other factors that affect gastric emptying. The next slide reviews a study published by Graham Parker in JPEN in 2001. And as discussed earlier, children with neurologic impairment often have delayed gastric emptying. And in this study, two diets with different whey percentages, Diet A had 18% of its protein as whey. Diet B had 50% of its protein as whey. Both these diets were compared in a randomized, controlled, double-blinded study. And each child, there were 20 children in the study, served as their own control in the crossover design. And a child would be fed one diet for 4 weeks and then switched to the other diet for another 4-week period. And caregivers were keeping records on how their child tolerated the formulas. And the results of this study show the diet with the higher percentage of protein in the form of whey, which was Diet B, resulted in significantly less gagging and retching. And the authors of the study concluded that there is a decreased retching and gagging reflex with a diet which is higher in whey protein. And this is most likely due to the fact that whey is able to remain in a liquid form in the stomach environment and can improve gastric emptying. When we follow a child with malabsorption issues, it's important to assess not only the source of the protein in the formula, such as whey versus casein versus soy or other, but also whether the protein is intact, partially hydrolyzed, or elemental. Many children can benefit from supplementation of intact protein-based formulas. These can be given enterally as well as by tube and are more palatable than peptide-based or free amino acid formulas. However, some children may require more specialized protein sources just to improve tolerance, for example. Free amino acid-based formulas can be especially helpful in children who have food allergies. For example, the child who presents with multiple food allergies, including milk and soy, and has allergic esophagitis and failure to thrive, would really benefit from the addition of a free amino acid to his or her diet. And we certainly see a lot of food allergies now.